Welcome to this very first video for the course that is called Sociology in a Global Perspective. In this clip, we are going to explore what the field of sociology is about. And although the science of sociology might not say much to you, everyone, including you, is subject to the forces that sociologists study. Please let me explain. Have you ever thought of how your life would look like if you had not been born in your home country, but in, let's say, China? Would your life be the same as it were now? Would you have the same beliefs and habits? Would you show the same behavior as now? Well, probably not. If you were born in China, you would have been raised in a completely different culture. To start with, you would have spoken a completely different language, like Mandarin or one of the many other dialects that exist in China. Instead of a fork and knife, you would have eaten your food using chopsticks. You would not have been able to directly turn down a request, as there is no word for no in Chinese vocabulary. The reason: directly saying no is considered to be extremely impolite, and therefore it doesn't exist. Furthermore, if you were born in China, you would probably not kiss or hug to greet friends or family. Only a nod would suffice. And if you had been born in China, chances are you would have been a boy, as there are many more boys than girls in China. Now, if you have ever asked yourself what you would be if you had not been born, if you had been born in a very different place or time, you're addressing a sociological question or a sociological issue. And in this clip, I would like to show you why that is. I want you to show what the field of sociology is about. The aim of this course is to develop a so-called sociological imagination. That is, I want you to see how remote and impersonal social forces shape your life and the life of others. Take the China example I gave again. Apparently, there is an enormous gender imbalance in China. For some reason, there are way more Chinese boys than girls. And that has severe consequences for a lot of individuals in China. Many Chinese men, for example, can't find a girl to marry, as there is an overall deficit of Chinese women. And for that reason, some Chinese stay alone for the rest of their lives. Now, how is this possible? It can be a coincidence that Chinese people predominantly receive male offspring. Sociologists study these matters. They want to understand the reason behind such phenomenon. In this case, they want to discover the social forces behind the gender imbalance in China. That is what sociology is about. It's about developing a perspective that shows people how their lives, like the lives of Chinese men that have big trouble in finding a partner, are shaped by the time and place they live in. It's about understanding that the way people behave, the things they do, are rooted in something bigger. Or, to put it more deliberately, sociology is about the perspective that shows us how our daily lives are shaped by remote and impersonal factors. Factors we call social forces. During this course, you're going to understand what that exactly means. You're going to explore your sociological imagination. Now, to develop that sociological imagination, you need to understand what social forces are. Here you find a definition. Social forces are any human-created ways of doing things that influence or force people to behave and think in certain ways. Well, that might sound vague, and therefore I'd like to give more examples of social forces. And in giving those examples, I would like you to introduce you to Rick. This is Rick. Rick is a 30-year-old American living in Chicago. He works as an ICT employee. To make a decent living, Rick has two jobs at two companies, and therefore Rick is mostly working. Unfortunately, Rick has overweight. He's way too heavy for his length. One of the reasons for his high weight, Rick eats quite unhealthy foods. Especially when he's working late, Rick often limits himself to fast food. Because of his weight, Rick suffers from heart disease. Rick is, however, not insured, and therefore he cannot afford a visit to a doctor. Now, the question a sociologist would raise is, what social forces influence Rick's life? What social forces, for example, make that Rick suffers from overweight? And what social forces influence Rick's choice for having an ICT career? In the remainder of this video clip, I would like to quickly address these questions in order to give you a bright idea of what social forces are about. So, to start with, why is Rick too heavy? Well, you could simply say because he chooses to eat unhealthy and to exercise too little. But for sociologists, such answer isn't satisfying because you see, Rick isn't the only American that suffers from overweight. Like him, there are many, many more. Take a look at this picture, for instance. Here you find the percentages of people that suffer from severe overweight, also called obesity. We see that in 1995, every state has an average percentage lower than 20. So the average level of obesity is in no state more than 20%. Compare that to the levels in 2010. That's quite a different picture, isn't it? Now, how is that possible? How did so many Americans become so much heavier? They can't all of a sudden have decided to eat less healthy altogether at the same time. So to put it in the words of a sociologist, what social forces are at the cause of this obesity issue? Well, take a look at the next interview and decide for yourself.
When fast food companies first opened, they generally introduced one size. For example, one size French fries when McDonald's first opened, called fries. That size fries is now called small, medium, large, and supersize. That original size is still here. It's got about 200 calories, but the supersize is going to pack in over 600 calories. When Burger King first opened, they had a 12-ounce small and a 16-ounce large. This 12-ounce is now kitty. The 16-ounce is now the small, the medium, the 32, and the 42. And this is across the board with all fast food places. Cars have introduced larger cup holders to accommodate those huge 7-Eleven double gulps, which are 64 ounces, a half gallon, and hold anywhere from 600 to 800 calories, depending on how much ice you put in.
A half gallon of soda.
A half gallon of soda for one person, 48 teaspoons of sugar.
My excuses for the poor quality, but I hope you understand what I'm getting at. Also take a look at this picture, which reinforces the things you just heard. Please compare the difference between what is considered as a medium soda in the USA on the one hand, and in Japan on the other. What is called a medium soda in Japan is considered to be a kiddie size in the USA. And also take a look at this. This picture is taken in a hospital. The presence of a McDonald's there is no exception. These days, Americans can get junk food pretty much anywhere. Now, the fast supply of junk food, including in hospitals, the development of growing portions of junk food, these are examples of social forces. They are remote and impersonal forces, as not one individual controls them, and they shape daily lives, as they influence people to behave in certain ways. In this case, Rick and many other Americans eating and drinking more than is healthy. Okay, let's get back to Rick. Another aspect of Rick's life is that he has an ICT-related job. He works with computers. Again, we can raise the question, why is Rick working in an ICT sector? One might say, because that is probably where his interests lie. And again, for sociologists, such answer isn't satisfying. Because you see, like Rick, there are many, many more. We live in an era in which technology develops very rapidly. Take for example this picture. Here you can see that the number of computers per 100 households increased with a factor 10 since 1999. And therefore, society needs employees like Rick. Also take a quick look on this picture. Here we see US employment divided in four different sectors. Notice the big increase in the services sector, exactly the sector Rick works in. If Rick would have been born, say, 50 years earlier, chances are he would not have had a job in the services sector, but in manufacturing instead. Now, the development of technology, the rise of the service sector, again, these are examples of social forces, remote and impersonal factors that influences the lives of individuals. In this case, the employment Rick and many, many other Americans have. Finally, Rick isn't insured. And also here, social forces are in play. Because you see, in the US, Rick isn't the only uninsured citizen. Like him, many other Americans don't have the financial ability to be properly insured. And again, this forces individuals to behave in certain ways. In this case, not going to a doctor even when you're sincerely sick. All right. So far for Rick and the social forces that apply to him. Please know that it is not my purpose to enlighten you about US obesity or healthcare system issues. What I hope this clip has made clear is how social forces can shape and influence the life of individuals, including your life. That is what we call the sociological imagination. I'm looking forward to explore the world of sociology with you in the coming weeks. For now, thanks for your attention.